been victimized, you've been traumatized, you may not have the verbal skills even to understand or talk about what happened. You may have been victimized by someone whom you knew very well. Now strangers are coming, and these strangers want you to tell them what happened. Maybe not even once, maybe twice, maybe more. How do you find a place, how do we find a place where that conversation can happen in a way that makes sense? Connie Baxter is going to speak to us today about the Windham County Safe Place. And that's a place where that conversation might happen.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Thank you for being here. Thank you for inviting me to talk with you. As Bob said, my name is Connie Baxter, and I'm the director of Windham County Safe Place Child Advocacy Center. We are also the Southeastern Unit for Special Investigations. We have the longest name, I think, of any nonprofit. It doesn't fit on any of those forms you have to fill out. So we're always looking for ways to abbreviate it. And what we want people to remember of that long name is, kind of small here, but a safe place. Because that's the essence of what we're trying to do for children who may have been abused, is to create a safe place, as Bob was saying, to tell adults about what has happened to them. This is a difficult subject, a serious subject, as Bob said. As a society, we prefer not to recognize that abuse happens to children. And I'll say up front that most of the abuse that professionals in the field are dealing with these days is sexual abuse of children. There have been a lot of strides made in preventing and reducing incidents of physical abuse of children, which is a terrible thing when that happens to kids, and it's great that we've made advances there. But we've got a long way to go in the field of child sexual abuse. It's a subject that even in the professional arena wasn't really addressed until starting about 30 years ago. In the first 10 years, not a lot happened, so most of the research that we have about child sexual abuse comes from the last 20 years. And every year there's more and more research and more attention that's paid to the problem. I want to say that for most people, even talking about the subject and hearing about the subject is very difficult. And whenever I speak to groups of people, I want to acknowledge that. And I want people to just be aware if emotional things come up for you throughout the day or in the days to come. very high-tech presentation here. So, just want to give you a general overview of the problem that we're talking about. So these all are national statistics, and where it's different in Vermont, I will make note of that. One in blank number of girls is sexually abused before the age of 18. I'd like to take a stab at what that number is. Pardon? One in four. I think we have an educated participant here. We may have to disqualify him from future questions. He's absolutely right. One in four girls will suffer some sort of sexual abuse before their 18th birthday. And we'll talk a little bit later about what that means. So what do you think it is for boys? The relationship of the offender to the child. We talk to our kids a lot about stranger danger. I think we've done a pretty good job of educating them about not to talk to strangers, don't take candy, don't get in a van with a stranger, all those things. So what percentage of offenders do you think are a stranger to the child nationally? 15, somebody says? 10. That is right. That's the national statistic. This is the one place where Vermont is quite different. We have a different percentage in Vermont. I'm going to take a guess. Smaller, Geralyn says. Five. Eight. Percentage in Vermont is 2%. So that means in 98% of cases where children in Vermont suffer sexual abuse, they know the offender. And usually it's quite a close relationship because that's how it happened. That's how the offender has access to your child. Moving on to my next page of high-tech presentation. Approximately how many out of 10 victims of child sexual abuse will report it during their childhood? One. Right. That's good. Only 1 out of 10 children will report it. And of these, I'll just fill in this blank. This was maybe a little, when somebody wants to take a guess. A lot of times it's an accidental disclosure. Out of innocence, a young child will just say, well, so-and-so did this with me. So the statistic on that is 70% of the time it's an accidental disclosure, unintentional. 1 out of how many cases of child sexual abuse is committed by a juvenile offender? Greg doesn't even know that one. Five? 1 out of 5? That's close. The number's actually 3. I think the exact figure in Vermont is 36% of the offenders are juveniles themselves. And while on the surface of it that might be a troubling statistic, we in the field look at this as a hopeful thing in that there's a lot of opportunity here for us to do prevention work with children. And I'll talk a little bit more about what's happening in Vermont for prevention. But a lot of these are learned behaviors. Many times we see juvenile offenders who have been victims themselves that nobody knows they've been a victim. It's learned behavior, the prevalence of pornography in people's homes and children's access. definitions, and you can get into a lot of, legal definitions, what our laws say. But I like to just go with what I consider the simplest definition, which is that child sexual abuse is any sexual activity with a child by an adult or an adolescent. And these can be either contact activities, touching, or non-contact, such as exposing a child to pornography, or asking a child to watch people engage in sexual activity. So it's a broad range. So when we talk about it, we're not always talking about the worst case scenario, which is where I think our minds go. But that's also not to say that even something that an adult might consider a rather minor offense isn't traumatic to a child. So let me talk about the work that we're doing here in Windham County. We started out 5 years ago as a special investigation unit. The state, about 5 or 6 years ago, took a look at how we were handling these crimes and realized that we weren't doing a very good job and that there was a better way. And so they put forward some money to counties to develop special investigation units similar to a special homicide unit or a drug task force that would address these crimes against children. And we started in Windham County just 5 years ago, in 2007, and we've grown a lot during that time. The idea is to train the people who do the investigations so that they are equipped as well as they can be to find out what has happened and to build a case. Law enforcement officers will tell you that these are probably the most difficult cases to investigate. And prosecutors will tell you they're probably the most difficult cases to prosecute. Because when you think about it, for the most part, these are crimes that are committed in secrecy with only two people present, and one of them is a child. And, a child has a lot of points against him or her as a credible witness just by the fact that he or she is a child. So the state realized we need to give special training to these investigators and do a better job. These are always joint investigations in Vermont. It's not true in other states, but in Vermont, it's a joint investigation between DCF, the Department for Children and Families, their abuse investigators, and law enforcement. And so a big part of my job is to try to get those folks to work together more closely, to coordinate their efforts, to bring in other professionals who get involved, like medical people who are highly specialized doctors and nurse practitioners who perform forensic medical exams on children to try to determine what abuse is taking place. To bring in mental health people, the treatment of the trauma, and then prosecution. We work with the state's attorney's office hard statistics on that. You know, anecdotally, we do see that. Usually it's the mother, because in most cases the offender is a male, although females do offend. But that's very difficult for us to sort out. Sometimes DCF knows the family well. They may have more information. Say if the mother knows that somebody is a sex offender and she brings him into the home. But that's one of the many challenges of these cases, is to identify the protective adult in this child's life who will work with us to make sure that they're not abused going forward. The question is, who reports? I don't have any hard statistics on that. Our reports, and reports are made to DCF. They have a central intake number, a hotline for child abuse reports. We don't take the reports directly. But very often the report comes from somebody at the school or the daycare center. Next, I guess, is family members, or maybe family members are first in how frequently they make the reports. The key here is a trusted adult in the child's life. That's usually how we find out. So when it's an intentional disclosure by the child, they're going to disclose to somebody they feel safe with. Because there are lots of reasons that kids don't disclose, why we get that only 1 in 10 will disclose. They're afraid they won't be believed. They think it's their fault. They somehow make the connection that they might get in trouble. They're gonna lose out on some of the good things the person is giving them or doing for them. I mean, I haven't brought up the Jerry Sandusky trial yet, but it's very much in the news. And of course, we don't know because it's in trial. But it would look to me like, you know, it's a classic case of giving children goodies. You know, I mean, some of the witnesses on the stand already have said, I didn't tell because I didn't want to lose the good things he was giving me, like taking me to football games and traveling on airplanes and taking me out to dinner and all those kinds of things. So, anyway, but what we emphasize in our educational outreach with people who work with children is to develop healthy relationships with adults, so that they have someone to go to talk to if they're concerned, if they're worried about something, if something doesn't feel right to them. So that question takes me back to the statistic of only 1 in 10 children will report during childhood. So I think the question, are we dealing with the tip of the iceberg? Unfortunately, I think we are dealing with the tip of the iceberg. And part of it is the discomfort that our society has with this subject. You know, the fact that it's something that is, there's so much secrecy around it. Children are told not to tell, sometimes they're threatened, you know, something bad will happen to you in the family if you tell somebody. So there's just so many layers of secrecy. So I feel like we're kind of pioneers in this. There's a very strong national movement to address child sexual abuse. There are national organizations, regional organizations, and there are more and more of these child advocacy centers coming online all the time. There's a tremendous amount of work to do. There is an effort in the public school system in Vermont to educate both adults who work in schools and children. There was legislation year before last called Act 1 legislation that mandated that schools will train every adult working in the building, so that includes the cooks and the maintenance people and everyone, about child sexual abuse, and also curriculum for children from kindergarten, maybe even pre-K through 12th grade. Initially, people go, oh my gosh, we're going to teach kids about this? Well, yes, we are. And that's how we arm them with the tools they need to my age kids. Anyway, they have told me that Windham County is doing a very good job of instituting this training in schools where it will. But there's no money in place to enforce or to follow up to make sure that schools are actually doing the trainings that they're supposed to be doing. So one of the things that I always ask people to do is talk to people in the schools, teachers, administrators. Ask them, what are you doing about the child sex abuse training? Have you trained your staff? Have you instituted the training in the classroom for children? Okay? It's an easy way to open the conversation to talk about this. Talk to parents. I think it's, most of us here don't have school-aged children, I would guess. But we know people who do have school-aged children. So talk to those parents. Have you had the conversation with your child about safety? Do you know what they're doing in the schools? There are so many effects from child sexual abuse throughout people's lives. There's all sorts of research about the mental illnesses, the substance abuse, addictions, teenage pregnancies, physical illnesses that folks feel that can be attributed to the trauma of early childhood sexual abuse. So as a cost to society, it's a tremendous cost in terms of just, you know, poor quality of life for victims. And again, I think this is especially true when they never tell. You know, therapists will tell you that all the time in their practice that they talk to adults of all ages who, for the first time, disclose that as a child. And they've been walking around with this burden. So there's a lot of loss of productivity, medical costs, societal costs in so many different ways, which is why I feel such urgency that it's, you know, it's more than just bad stuff happening to little kids. It affects all of us.
The easy question is there a website, contact information? Do you even have a newsletter?
This is ours. On the bottom is our website for Safe Place. These are
Safe Place, CAC.
Right.
CAC.
We couldn't get just Safe Place. Somebody else already had that. So we're Safe Place CAC. CAC in our world stands for Child Advocacy Center. Protect Kids Vermont. Oh, it's .net. Yeah, we couldn't get .org. Somebody else had that too. So we got .net. Protect Kids .vermont, .vt.gov is the state's website. Has a great, a lot of resources. Prevent Child Abuse Vermont, well-known organization, their website. And this is a really good national resource called Stop It Now. They happen to be located in Northampton, Massachusetts. They do a lot of really good work. It is something that came out of a child advocacy center in Chicago, which we use, which is really helps people to understand what a child advocacy center is. It talks about what used to happen when kids reported abuse, and how many different people they had to talk to, and, you know, people just kept, you know, asking them, now tell me. And each time the child repeats the account, it's traumatizing. So the goal is to have them tell it only once. Get it right the first time, get it recorded, have everybody who needs to see it and hear it, do it once. So that's our goal. We're not always able to do that, but most of the time it is a one-time interview with the child. Oh, there was a hard question. We didn't get to that yet.
This is perhaps a harder question. I was asked to ask you about restorative justice, so I'll
about that, that is a difficult question. The short answer I would say is I think we could get there with many victims and offenders to have a restorative model. I think what's really important for many victims is for the overall healing process is to someday be able to sit down with their offender and have an honest conversation about how that abuse affected them. I feel like where we are in the way that the cases are investigated and prosecuted and followed up, we aren't there yet. I mean, I think it happens on an individual basis. I mean, you can read in some of the literature and the research about people who've had that deathbed conversation with a father or stepfather, where finally before that person dies, they have some measure of healing. But I think it's very, very difficult for people. And I think the victim, and I speak more from the victim's point of view, there's also an offender's point of view because we're dealing with human beings here. We're all humans. But for the victim, there's a lot of work that needs to go into that healing process before it could be a constructive conversation and a restorative model. Right now, the bulk of our funding comes from the state. The state has been very supportive of the special investigation units and the child advocacy centers. In these tough years financially, last 2 or 3 years, we have not lost funding and maybe just about the only budget line in the legislative budget that has had increased funding. But as well we should, because we're very far behind where we should be addressing this huge societal problem. We get grants from the state. I just sent off my second of my major grant applications yesterday. It's always a relief. We get support from the Northeast Regional Child Advocacy Center in terms of training. They're great about helping us to send people away for training or bringing training to us. Last month, I went to a great team facilitator training in New Hampshire that was sponsored by the Northeast Region. The national organization gives us some support as well. We are a nonprofit. We do fundraising. We'd love to get donations. We haven't done much yet in terms of fundraising because we are such a small and new organization. We did do a direct appeal last fall. We got just under $2,000, which we thought was great because nobody had heard about us. We are planning a fundraising event this fall, I hope. It's a nighttime golf tournament. Sounded like a crazy idea to me, but apparently golfers think this is a lot of fun to go out in the dark and shoot these light up balls and wear glow sticks around their necks, and you put a glow stick on the tee, and not the tee, but the place you're trying to hit the ball to, you can see out over the hole. And so we're hoping to do that. I think maybe at Mount Snow we're getting close to an agreement there. So look for us for that if you know any golfers. And any ideas that folks have about fundraising, you know, somebody's doing an event and they want a nonprofit organization to get the proceeds from, please remember us. And we are looking for board members as well.
Thank you very much. Final comment?
Yeah, I really want to thank you all for being here. As I said, it's a hard topic. We try to do presentations for parents in schools. We get like a whole panel of experts, and there are usually more people on the panel than there are in the audience. It's really difficult to hear about, so I commend you all for getting up early this morning and coming to hear my presentation. Thank you. And one more thing. Come and visit us. We have great children's artwork in our Child Advocacy Center. It's very warm and welcoming, and yes, the children's artwork is from the River Gallery, a subscription art program. I've worked very hard to set it up so that when kids walk in the door, they feel like it's a place for children. So we love to have visitors. Please come and visit. And take materials from the table over there.
Thank you. breakfast, but then some people came to us with ideas. So I still have to nail down the actual dates. It may not be the third Friday of the month, we may move that up a bit. But it looks like the West River Trail in July, and Ken Schneck has a new class on the college and the community to be taught at the River Garden come the fall, and he wants to give you a preview in August here. Thank you very much for your attentiveness this morning. It was a difficult topic, and I'm glad you're all here. Thank you. Thank you, Tom.
Yes, if anybody wants to talk to me directly, I'm here.